here. It's good to see some familiar faces, some new faces, and some faces I haven't seen for a while. It's good. I'm Jeff, one of the leaders here. My wife, Verna Sue, are on holidays right now. I'm assuming we're live, right, Darren? Hello, live Facebook people. We miss you. Thank you for tuning in with us as well. And anyways, I'm just going to open up and we're going to get into it. It's today we're doing a message on worship. And so I'm going to invite the Holy Spirit to come and let's wait for a second here this morning. And I'm just going to invite the Holy Spirit to come and we'll just wait. And what I'm doing when I do that is I'm not trying to posture myself or try to get into some sort of a religious stance or something like that. I'm just kind of going, God, here I am. And sometimes I don't know why I'm doing this or why I'm here or what's going on, but here I am. And help me to focus on you. Help me to fix my mind on you, my thoughts on you. Laying down any shame that's in my life and just going, God, I just want to encounter you. So I'm just going to invite the Holy Spirit to come. Holy Spirit, come and be with us. Help this morning to be about you. Help us to be able to just fall at your feet and worship you. Come, Holy Spirit. Come to those places of our lives that trouble us, that we think separate us from you, or we think you're disappointed in us. Come into those deep places. Come into the wounds. Come into those deep places, Father. Show us your love. Show us how much you care. Show us how happy you are with us. How pleased you are with us. Come, Holy Spirit. Online and in your homes, it's no different than being here. Slow it down. Allow the Father to speak to you. Allow his kindness, his peace to wash over you. Come, Holy Spirit. Come and be with us this morning. Fill this place. Fill the homes. Fill us with joy. Help us to worship you. Amen. So you guys are welcome to stand, move around. We're just going to try to keep our distance from people that aren't in your bubble. And we're just going to worship.
Spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. For I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind. So kind to me. no shadow, you won't light up. Mountain, you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall, you won't kick down. Lie, you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow, you won't light up. Mountain, you won't climb up. You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Has called my name. I've been born again into a family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father, so you
worship team. I just think everyone should know that this is my niece, Caitlin. She's 14 and she's amazing and we love her, and we're just so thankful to our worship team this morning. That was really great. So welcome everybody who's here. It's good to see your faces, and welcome for those who are tuning in online. We are with you in spirit. We know that the Holy Spirit is with us no matter where we are. So welcome this morning. We just have a few announcements. We want to say a huge congratulations to Ruben and Rachel Vanderveen. They had a little baby boy. I think he's about a week old now. His name's Josiah. If you're friends with them on Facebook, they've been putting some pictures up of him, and he is beautiful and adorable. So congratulations to them. That's so exciting, their first baby. Another announcement. So Thursdays at 7 o'clock, we go live just for a bit of sharing time with the Word. And if anybody needs prayer, we're on Facebook at 7 on Thursdays, which has been really, really good. August 8th. So we've had some prophetic words coming in. Jonah has, the Lord has given him a prophetic word in regards to this church and just what God is doing, what God is doing right now. And so and we've also had a few others. So we're going to take August 8th as a worship and prayer night. I think we're calling it Awakening, right, Jeff? Called it Awakening Night. And we're just going to be praying into those words and have some time for worship and so that we can really spend some time to hear from the Holy Spirit and what he's saying. And so we want to honor prophecy in this church, and so that's one way that we're going to do that. So August 8th at 7 o'clock, we're going to have that. So mark your calendars for that. We also want to say a huge thank you to all our volunteers. So when Jeff and I were away for a month, and now that Vern and Sue are away for a month, like, we just had a lot of help, and we couldn't do it without the help that we've had. So I just want to say thank you. So Stan was here. He was cleaning and doing the bathrooms and the back door so amazingly. And Lorand took over for him. He's been doing the back door as well. Josh and Molly and the Dirksen family. Darren Tomke, who's been back there so faithfully doing the technology aspect of things. And Sam and Miles with sound, and Al with sound, George with the front door, Zoe, who's been here for both of our services with the kids, Rebecca, who does an amazing job with all our admin and everything that you see up there, and just she's incredible as well, and Lyle and Tom, who's been doing media, and our worship teams. During this whole COVID crazy season, people have been so generous with their time, and so we're just so thankful for that, so we just wanted to say a huge thank you there. So that's it for announcements, and I'm going to transition to the other part. So today we're going to continue on in our culture series. We're talking about a culture of what we value here at the Vineyard, what Vern and Sue have nurtured for the past 25 years, and what Jeff and I hope to continue on as we take over as lead pastors, this sort of culture that we want here at the Vineyard. And so this morning we're going to be talking about a culture of worship. What does it mean to worship God, and why do we worship God? You know, our whole lives are meant to be lived out as worship. Our whole lives are worship unto the Lord. In everything that we do, it's worship to Him. Worship is what you're devoted to. Where does your devotion and affection lie? What do you look to? What do you run to? What do you fix your gaze on? What do you spend your time focusing on? This is worship to the Lord. And so our whole lives are meant to be that, this devotion to the Lord, our whole lives directed to Him. Whether it's with our marriages, our relationships, our children, our jobs, and no matter what we're doing in our lives, that it's all for Him. It's all unto Him. Romans 14:8, Paul says this. He says, if we live, we live for the Lord. And if we die, we die for the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. So if we belong to Him, then everything that we do is for Him. We are His. We are His precious children. We belong to Him. And so our lives are lived for Him. Colossians 3:17 says that whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus. Do it all in His name, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. This is true worship. And no matter what you're doing, that it's all for Jesus. Today we're going to be talking about worship. But we're going to talk about worshiping God through music and through song. We can worship God in many ways, but worshiping God through music and song is such a huge part of our faith. It's such a huge part of the scriptures. It's a huge part of church culture, not just this church. The Vineyard itself birthed a worship movement many, many years ago, and they really affected the worship culture of the church with that movement. And so worshiping God through music and song is just a huge part of the culture of the Vineyard worldwide and a huge part of this Vineyard. So we're going to talk about that today. I'm going to pray, and then we're going to get to the message. So, Father, I just thank you that we have the privilege to worship you, that you created us this way, so that we wouldn't be looking to anything else to fulfill us, Lord, but that we would look to you. And so we just pray that you would do that this morning, that you would fill our hearts and fill us with what you want to give us and come and speak to our hearts and pierce our hearts this morning, Lord. I give this to you. Amen. So we have a son. He is 11 years old, our middle son, Sawyer. And when he was born, he had a cloud in his left eye. So this beautiful, he was so beautiful, he was so cute, and you know, just staring at this beautiful life. And when he was about a few days old, my husband and I looked in his eye and we're like, that's something. Like, that's not like a reflection. There's definitely something in his eye. So we take him to the doctor, and we wait this long process to get to the specialist. We drive to Edmonton to go to this ophthalmologist for children and do all these tests, and we find out that Sawyer was actually blind, that he had a cataract in his left eye that was so large that it clouded over his whole lens. The whole lens of our eye, which is kind of what helps us to see, his lens was clouded over completely with a cataract. So he was only seeing out of one eye. So when he was 2 months old, he had surgery, and he's had a few since then, but he had surgery to remove the lens of his eye. So the whole lens of his eye was removed, and we're just so thankful to this day that God has done a miracle in that child's life. We're thankful for the prayers, we're thankful for the doctors, that now Sawyer, who they didn't know how well he'd see. They didn't think that he would be able to get a driver's license and all that because they thought he'd only have sight in his one eye, but he's regained sight in that eye. He has 20/30 vision, which the doctor is constantly amazed at. Every ophthalmologist appointment, the doctor is amazed at how well Sawyer can see out of this eye. He wears a contact that he puts in every morning, takes out it, or at least he's supposed to put it in. He can see pretty good out of the other eye. He kind of favors that eye, so he doesn't always put it in, but he does wear a contact, and he wears glasses, and he can see. He can see. He can see the way that he was meant to see. He's no longer blinded. He does not have this obstructed vision. He was born with this obstructed vision. He couldn't see the way that he was meant to see. And I think that some of us have obstructed vision. I think that some of us have clouds in our eyes. Some of us are not seeing the way that we are meant to see. Hebrews 12:2 says this, that we fix our eyes on Jesus. Our eyes fixed on Jesus. He's who we are meant to see, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. This is how we're meant to see, and I'm not talking about physically. I know many of us have problems with our eyes physically. I'm talking spiritually. What really matters is seeing Jesus, is fixing our eyes on him. And that sometimes when we go through life, our eyes just become clouded. We have distractions. We have worries and cares. We go through trials and tribulations, and our eyes become clouded, our vision becomes obstructed, and we're not seeing the way we're meant to see. We're not seeing Jesus with both our eyes fixed on him. And we just need the Holy Spirit to come sometimes. We just need him to come and clear our vision. We need the Holy Spirit to come and just wipe the clouds away so we can fix our eyes on Jesus. And worshiping God, particularly through music, through song, is one very powerful way that God clears our vision. One very powerful way that God corrects our lenses so that we can see the Lord, where we can put on these glasses almost to see Jesus, to behold him. To behold him. So that's what I pray this morning as we go into this, that Holy Spirit, that you would come and just clear our vision this morning, Lord. And wipe away the clouds. We want to see you. We want to see you. I want to talk about this morning just different ways that worship works in our lives, different aspects of worship. So the first one is praise. This is one aspect of worship. We praise God through song. We exalt him, we lift him high, and we acknowledge his work and his power in our lives and among the earth. We just praise him because he's worthy. We praise him, we exalt the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We just praise him. This is a very important part of our worship. Psalm 63, 4 to 5, David says, I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. I will be fully satisfied as with the richest of foods, with singing lips, my mouth will praise you. And praise him. And see, sometimes just we're going through life and our vision can become clouded with ourselves. Our vision becomes clouded with just our own self, and we forget the one through whom all things come. Sometimes we give ourselves too much glory. Sometimes we forget to lay our crowns at his feet, to acknowledge that everything comes from him. It is all for him, and so we praise him and we exalt him. We need our vision cleared. Sometimes we are like the 9 lepers. There's a story in the New Testament in Luke 17. There are 10 lepers, and they come to Jesus. Lord, will you make me clean? Will you heal me? And Jesus says, go, you are clean. Go show yourself in the temple. So the 10 lepers, they run to the temple to be declared clean so they can re-enter into society and no longer live with shame. They've been healed, and only one comes back. Only one leper comes back and praises him. It says that the leper praises him and gives him thanks. He thanks the Lord. And Jesus says this to him in Luke 17, 18. Has no one else returned to give praise to God except this foreigner? Where are the other 9? Where is the rest of the praise to God for the miracle, for the deliverance? And so this is part of worship. We praise him, and we give him praise, and we acknowledge his work in our lives. Romans 11, 36 is that for from him and through him and for him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Amen. That we don't take any of that glory, for from him and for him and through him are all things. Through praise, we acknowledge his victory and his deliverance that he's given to us. Exodus 15, 1-2, the Israelites, they were traveling through the desert. They were running out of Egypt. God had delivered them from slavery, but it wasn't over yet. See, they hit the Red Sea, and it looks like they can't go any further, and the Egyptians, their enemy is like hot on their tails, and they hit this Red Sea. And it looks like they're doomed, like they can't go any further, like it's all over. They're going to have to go back to slavery. But Jesus, God, he parts the Red Sea for them. The Lord parts the Red Sea and make a way where there was no way. God makes a way for them through the Red Sea. They come up on the other side of the Red Sea. And then God destroys their enemies, and they really are free now. They really are free. They've been delivered. This is, of course, a picture of what Jesus has done for us. We really are free. We really have been delivered from sin and death. But they sing a song to him on the other side of the Red Sea, which I love. It says in Exodus 15, 1-2, that Moses and the Israelites sang this song to the Lord. I will sing to the Lord, for he is highly exalted. Both horse and driver, he's hurled into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my defense. He has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will praise him. My father's God, and I will exalt him. See, they look back, and they saw what God had done in their lives, and they gave him praise. That's the first thing they do. They come up on the other side of the Red Sea and they give him praise. God, you did that. That's part of our worship to the Lord, where we look back and we say, God, you did that. You delivered me. You gave me the victory. And we look back and see all the amazing things that God has done in our lives, and we praise him for it. And we see what Jesus has done for us on the cross, and we praise him. We praise him for his deliverance in our lives. Psalm 22:3 from the Passion Translation. I love how the Passion puts this. It talks about God being with his people. It says, you are God enthroned, surrounded with songs, living among the shouts of praise of your princely people. Other translations say that he inhabits the praises of his people. And God is here. He is among us. He is with us. And we praise the God who is with us. And we give him praise. The Holy Spirit comes into that, and his presence becomes known as we praise him. So we just give God praise in our worship. It's part of, it's just part of worshiping God. So you have praise on the one hand over here, and kind of on the other end of that, you have lament. So lament is a very important part of worship as well. When we are, you know, lament is just it's our suffering. It's our pain. It's our expression of our pain. That when we're going through the valley, when we're walking through darkness, we lament and we offer up that suffering to God. That's lament, where we're offering up our pain to the Lord. We give that part of our lives to him. And sometimes in life, you know, our vision can become clouded and we're just, our vision obstructed from the pain and the grief, and we forget that God wants that part of our lives too. We don't think he wants to hear it. And we forget that God wants the good and the bad and the ugly. He wants all of it. He wants all of it. And our eyes can become clouded if we hold that stuff in, if we don't give that to him. We need eyes to see Jesus, who says, come to me and give me your burdens. Give me your burdens. Give them to me. Tell me how you're suffering. Tell me how you feel. Express those deep parts of your life. Express those deep parts of yourself. Pour yourself out to me, says the Lord. Pour yourself out to me. Lament is a very important part of our faith. That, you know, sometimes things just don't always go the way we want them to go. And instead of being like, oh, I'm strong, I can do this, it's like, no, Lord, I'm suffering and I'm broken and here it is. Will you come? And God enters into that place with us. When we lament, God enters into our suffering. That's why Jesus came, to enter in, to become like us, enter into our suffering. And we grieve with those who grieve. So we can come to the Lord and we grieve for our own selves. And we also want to remember that Jesus says that we mourn with those who mourn. So we make it part of our worship, where we offer up lament to the Lord. I know Brian Dirksen, who is a huge part of the Vineyard, has so many wonderful songs of lament. And there's been songs of lament released in this season as well, as the whole world is suffering. That's a huge part of scriptures as well. 2 Chronicles 35:25. It says that Jeremiah composed laments for Josiah. And to this day, all the male and female singers commemorate Josiah in the laments. These became tradition in Israel and were written in the laments. It's a huge part of our faith, this lamenting. Amen. You know, Jeremiah was the weeping prophet. He lamented a lot. And it needed to be done in that season. Josiah, who he wrote these laments for, was a good king. He was a good king. It says that he did right in the eyes of the Lord. And every king before him, there were so many evil kings that were before him, and evil kings that came after him. And so Jeremiah was lamenting and grieving this king, this good king. And needed that that emotion to be expressed to God. We need to acknowledge our pain. And when we do that, when we acknowledge what we're going through and we give that to the Lord, He enters into it and His presence comes. And where the presence of God is, there is hope. So He enters into that pain and He gives us hope. It says in Psalm 43:5, "Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for yet I will praise Him, my Savior and my God." The psalmist in Psalm 43, he's just pouring himself out to God, giving Him his pain. And in the end, he says, "Yet I have hope. I'll put my hope in the Lord. He has heard my suffering, and I will put my hope in Him." And so through lamenting, our hope can be restored as well. So we make that part of our worship. Another part of worship is that it's an act of surrender. It's an act of surrender. You know, when I first started going to church, and this whole church scene was new to me, people would raise their hands and put their hands out, and I just thought it was the weirdest thing. I was like, what? That is so strange. Like, that's embarrassing. You know, why would you do that? And I didn't get it. I get it now, but... And I remember somebody somewhere along the line said to me, I don't even remember who it was. I heard someone say, you know, when we worship God, it's an act of surrender. And so when you see people with their hands open, with their hands raised, it's an act of surrender. That's what worship is. It's an act of surrender. And I'm talking about the heart. We don't always have to raise our hands. Not everybody does that, but it's an act of surrender of our hearts, of our wills. Sometimes our eyes can become clouded through ambition and goals and success, what we want out of life. We're saying, hey, Jesus, I'm going this way, so come with me. And so we're not fixing our eyes on Him because we're not looking to Him for direction. We're going our own way. And we need some clear vision so that we can see Jesus, so that we can follow Jesus. We forget that He's the one who wants to direct our paths, who wants to guide us and lead us in the way that we should go. He wants our lives. He wants it all. And He wants us to surrender to Him and say, here, Lord, your will be done. My life belongs to you. You came and gave yourself to me, for me. I belong to you, Lord. Have your way. I want to do things your way. Jeremiah 10:23, the prophet says, Lord, I know that people's lives are not their own. It is not for them to direct their steps. Psalm 48:14 says that this God is our God forever and ever, and He will be our guide even to the end. He is our guide. He is the one who sets the good and perfect way that we should walk in. Doesn't mean it's always easy, but it's always going to be good. Because Jesus is there and we're following Him. He knows the beginning from the end. And through worship, we just surrender to Him. We say, Lord, You're worthy. You're worthy of all my life. I trust You, Lord. I trust You. Come have Your way. Come have Your will be done in my life. And even through worship, we ask the Holy Spirit to come into those places that we're withholding from Him, to break down those walls so that we can give our entire lives to Him and surrender to Him fully. This is a powerful thing that God does in worship, is He helps us just to surrender to Him and want to surrender. Like, want to give it to Him because we trust Him. And just surrender our lives to Him. Lastly, I want to speak about unity. This is a really powerful part of worship. Before I get to that, I just want to say, like, I'm only mentioning a few things today. Like, worship is so much broader than all of this. Worship is such a huge part of our lives, and we could spend a whole series on this. But I'm just sharing with you today some things that God has put on my heart when it comes to worship. So unity. This one's really close to my heart, Jeff's and Vernon's, Sue, this aspect of unity in the church. And worship is a very powerful expression of the unity of the body of Christ. It's my favorite sound in the whole world to hear the body of Christ worshiping with that one voice. We all come together, with our uniqueness, with our diversity, and we worship the one true God, and it unites us. Sometimes in worship, our eyes can become, sometimes in life, our eyes become clouded, become clouded with our differences, with our own opinions, with our own rightness and other people's wrongness, how other people think theologically and politically and on Facebook. We determine how good people are and if they're going to be our friends, whether or not we like their posts on Facebook. And we are divided. And our eyes are so clouded. Lord, help us clear our vision so that we can see you, so that we can worship you, so that we can become united in worshiping the one true God, so the world may know that you are Lord. Through the unity of the church, the world will know. They will know Jesus. They will know their Savior. It is a testimony to the world, our unity. And worship is a testimony as well to who the one true God is, and that we worship him no matter where we come from, no matter what we think. We worship God with one spirit and one voice. Ephesians 4:4 says that we have one Lord and one faith and one baptism, one body, one spirit. You're called to one hope. We are one. And worship is just a symbol of that oneness. And so we come together and we worship God in just unity. It's so pure. It's so pure. That's what I love about it, the sound of God's people worshiping him. It's so pure. Because there's one purpose in it. We're not trying to get anything out of it. We're just worshiping God, and it's such a pure sound. Romans 15, 5-6. It says, "May the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you the same attitude of mind toward each other that Christ had. So with one mind and one voice, you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." It says that we should accept one another as Christ accepted us in order to bring praise to God. Our unity brings praise to God, and we want to do that through worship. We want our unity of spirit to be known in this church through worship, through lots of ways, but through worship. And we just say, come, Holy Spirit, in all of this. Worship is really this, come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. This is a huge just phrase in the Vineyard. Come, Holy Spirit. As we worship you, we just say, come, Holy Spirit, come, have your way. Come, Holy Spirit, as we praise you, as we exalt you, as we lift up the name of Jesus. Come, Holy Spirit, as we pour out our pain and our suffering. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, as we surrender our lives to you. Come, show me the way to walk. Come, Holy Spirit. And we say, come, Holy Spirit. Come, give us the unity and the oneness that you intended for your church. Come, Holy Spirit. We are nothing without your presence. We are nothing without you. Come, Holy Spirit. This is worship. Come, Holy Spirit. I just want to read to you again Ephesians 5:19. It says to be filled with the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. Through worship, we are filled with the Spirit. It says that we speak to one another with psalms and hymns and songs from the Spirit, that we sing and make music from our heart to the Lord. We do it on Sunday mornings, and we do it throughout our whole week. We make music to the Lord from our hearts. God does that. He gifts people with the gift of worship, and he puts songs in people's hearts, and then it blesses the church. So many amazing worship songs coming out in this season, and we're just so thankful for the gift of worship that God has put on people's lives in this church. Jeff and I are just, we're so thrilled, we're so thankful for the work that God has done in our worship community in this church. That the growth that God has given in regards to worship community in this church amazes us. You know, Jeff goes to our worship team, he kind of puts the schedules together, and it's like there's so many. It's so amazing, and we're so thankful for what God is doing, and we cry out for more. We cry out for more of that growth that God gives. I mean, the fact that we had Caitlin up worshiping this morning, we're just so thankful that God is bringing new growth, newness, just all this newness, and we love it. We love it. We're so thankful for our worship team. And so Jonah, he's going to come up, and he's going to join me. He is one of our worship leaders. Yeah, come on up. He's one of our worship leaders. We've been in relationship with Jonah and his wife, Rebecca, for a few years now. You can just come on this side here, Jonah. We've been in relationship with them for a few years, and they've been just a blessing to Jeff and I, to our lives. We love them so much, and we love their heart. They have such pure hearts for God. And so Jonah's just going to share his heart this morning when it comes to worship. So, Jonah, you go ahead and you just take it.
Okay. I have some stuff written here, but I want to say that, like, worship is something that's very dear to me. And since the moment I got saved and I got on my knees and I gave my life to Jesus, I just started worshiping him right off the bat. And it's something that's always been very personal to me. But even when, like, I come up here and I'm singing songs and leading us in, like, corporate worship, it's still possible for me to not even be thinking about Jesus during it. Like, it's actually possible for us to lift our hands and to sing songs that are to Jesus without actually worshiping him from the heart. And that's something that, like, I always have to recenter myself to be like, And everything we're doing, even the outward signs that look like worship, you still have to have this heart position that's actually directed toward God, to put him before all things. So that's kind of what I'm going to talk about a little bit. I just want to share my heart on what worship truly is. And a lot of it is what Megan already covered, but this is what I wrote. So worship is a matter of the heart. Worship is a perspective. It is directional. It is unto something or someone. Jesus said that the eye is the lamp of the body. And if your eye is good, your whole body will be full of light. Your eye is your perspective. When your gaze is on Jesus only, your whole being is filled with light. This is worship, fixing your eyes on Jesus. Worship is something we all do, whether we're aware of it or not. It is not always accompanied by an outward action, but it can be. God looks at the heart and sees what the heart adores. True worship to me is exactly what Jesus said it is. The Samaritan woman in John chapter 4 conversed with Jesus about the location in which people should worship God, but Jesus redirected her attention from a location to a heart position. He said, "The hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." This passage means a lot to me because Jesus clarifies that worship is from within, and that true worship is founded in truth. God doesn't just desire us to pay homage when we gather. He wants us to continually have our affections set upon him, and in this way, there's fullness of joy. When we come to Jesus, there is true rest. God created us for him, so naturally true satisfaction comes from a relationship with him. And this relationship is nurtured by adoring Jesus in spirit and in truth. Now, there's a very insightful passage of scripture that I think of quite often when I'm going through trials. It says in Acts chapter 16, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's bonds were unfastened. So the reason that Paul and Silas were thrown into prison in the first place is because they're doing God's will. And yet in the midst of their trial, they still sang to the Lord. Their hearts were set on Jesus. They could have been down and out. They could have been mad at God for not keeping them from going to prison, but rather they kept their hearts pure and desired God in the midst of persecution. They worshiped God in their trial. Some of us here are currently in trials. Some of us online, we're in trials right now. We feel like we're in some sort of prison in our minds. We feel that we're continually getting beat down by the enemy. But I want to say to all of you right now that he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. So take courage and fix your eyes on Jesus. Worship him from your heart. When you're in your darkest hour, at midnight, when you're surrounded by fear and torment, just lift up your heart to God, sing to him praise. Thank him for his goodness. He will unfasten your bonds. And one of the most beautiful things about this is that he'll give the people around you freedom as well, just as the prisoners' bonds were unfastened and the door swung open. So I just want to end by sharing this last bit of scripture. It's a passage found in Philippians 4. It says, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Joan. I really appreciate that. You know, one thing that he was saying, this purity of heart that we need as we worship God, that it's not about the outward actions, but about what God is doing in our hearts. That I was listening to this song last night by Jeremy Riddle, and it says, purify my heart. Crying out to the Lord, purify my heart. We want to worship you, like Jonah said, in spirit and truth. So I pray that for all of this, for all of us this morning. We're going to take communion now, which I probably should have prepared us for earlier, but we're going to take communion. So if in your homes, if you want to grab some communion, we're going to take it now as a body. There is a table over there by the front door, a table to my left and my right. So if you want to grab communion, we're going to do that as a family together. Worship is a really powerful way, as I said, to express this unity. And what we do when we take communion is it's just a symbol, it's an action of our unity. And I think that communion, that yes, it's a sign and a symbol, but something powerful happens in the spirit when we take communion. Like God just works. He just does some work in our hearts when we take communion. And so that's part of what we're doing right now, is asking the Holy Spirit to come and do a work in us, to give us that pure heart, as Jonah was talking about, to worship God in spirit and truth.
Yes, I am.
To give us a heart of unity that would come together and declare the one true God. So if you want to take the blood and the body of Jesus, we just say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your body. Thank you that you unified us through your body. Thank you that you work so actively in our lives in every aspect. Thank you that you've given us worship. Thank you that you've given us worship. Thank you for the gift of worship. So as we take this communion, we just say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And we just thank everybody online. We love you, and we just pray a blessing over you, this week, and I just encourage all of us here and online to take some time this week, get alone with God, even if it's in the car on the way to the grocery store, to worship Him. To put on your favorite worship song and just worship Him. And we just pray, Holy Spirit, that you would come into that place, that you would meet us this week. Come encounter us this week, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So goodbye to all of you. We love you. And if you need prayer, you can contact us. You can email Chilvine. Jeff had something.
Oh, no. I was just going to help you wrap up here.
Okay, go ahead.
I'll join in. So as we go out the back, because the next service is going to be coming in the front. If you were done, I'll just go to the practical stuff.
Just do it, yeah.
Yeah, practical stuff. So we'll go at the back. The gate will be open. Justin will be back.